Well, good afternoon, and welcome again to the new year. I know we had an all-hands a few days ago that was a great all-hands led by our IT folks. It was wonderful. This is our first innovation lecture series speaker of the new year, and I'm very happy that we were able to get Mr. Stephen Shapiro with us today. He's one of the foremost authorities on innovation culture, collaboration, and open innovation. And I got to be with Stephen at a meeting about a year ago in Dayton, Ohio, and I've kept up with him since, so I'm very pleased to have him here today. During the past 20 years, his message to hundreds of thousands of people in 40 countries around the world is focused on how to enable innovation by bringing together divergent points of view in an efficient manner. So for those of you that were at the supervisor all hands today within NASAâ, you'll know that one of Mike Coates' big pushes still is innovation and inclusion, and that is precisely about bringing together a lot of different and new ideas together in the team. Over the years, Stephen has shared his innovative philosophy in books such as 24/7 Innovation and The Little Book of Big Innovation Ideas. He's also trained more than 20,000 consultants in innovation during his 15-year tenure with Accenture, and his personality poker card game has been used by more than 50,000 people around the world to create high-performing innovation teams. His work has been featured in Newsweek, Entrepreneur Magazine, The Oprah Magazine, The Wall Street Journal, and New York Times. And I'll let you tell you about some of his clients and work that he's done, and I don't want to take any more of his time. So, Stephen, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. So you've all heard someone use the expression, we can send a man to the moon, but we can't blank. I mean, we can send a man to the moon, but we can't make a toaster that doesn't burn the bread. One of the things I've discovered is that people have a fascination with space travel. And I'm absolutely convinced that aerospace engineering is considered to be the most complex discipline in the universe, with brain surgery being a distant second. So we hear people use this expression, it's not rocket science. And when you use that expression, basically what we're saying is it's something that's not complex because rocket science is complex. Now, I would never suggest that rocket science or aerospace engineering challenges are simple. However, I want you to consider, at least for the presentation here, that sometimes rocket science isn't rocket science. And what I mean by that is sometimes the best solutions, the breakthrough solutions, are not going to come from the realm of aerospace engineering, and sometimes the breakthrough solutions are incredibly simple. I want to just give you one very quick thing to think about before we kick off here. This is a brain teaser that I like, and I want you just for yourself to think about what you think the answer might be. If the timepiece with the fewest moving parts is a sundial, what is the timepiece with the most moving parts? Now, most people, when I ask them this question, they immediately think of the universe, and I would think that that's probably where a lot of you went, but I'm actually looking at a real timepiece, something that would fit inside of this room. So our natural inclination, and we start thinking complex things like, you know, maybe a nuclear clock, or maybe a grandfather clock, or a really nice Swiss watch. The reality is, it is something that I have in my pocket. The timepiece with the most moving parts is not something that is overly complex, but rather it is an hourglass. Now, our natural inclination with everything is to make things complex. So what I want to do during our time together is to explore three concepts, and these three concepts will be explained by three quotes from three famous people. So I'm going to start off with a quote from Einstein, then I'll move to a quote from Steve Jobs, and I'll close with a quote from Edison. And these three quotes will give you a sense of the content that I want to talk about today, which is how do we accelerate the way we develop breakthrough solutions? Because here's the reality. I know in this room and on the WebEx and anybody watching the video that we have some of the brightest people on the planet inside of NASAâ. There's no disputing that. However, there is always an opportunity to innovate faster, innovate with lower risk, innovate at lower cost, because I'm guessing that your budgets are not increasing. Therefore, the question is, how do you do more innovation with a little less money? And that's what I want to explore. To start things off, I want to test your memory. What was in the news across the newspapers, the Twitter feeds, and everywhere around the world on April 20th, 2010? Anybody remember what was in the news on April 20th, 2010? What? Yes, the Deepwater Horizon oil rig. On April 20th, 2010, the Deepwater Horizon oil rig exploded. Over the course of the next 87 days, 180 million gallons of crude oil were pumped into the Gulf Coast. And if you followed the news, BP tried six or seven different breakthrough approaches to try to stop the flow of the oil, and none of those worked. So they turned to something that a lot of people in the innovation space are doing these days, which is crowdsourcing. So BP set up a website, and on that website it said, "We have a problem, do you have a solution?" And basically they opened it up to concerned citizens and scientists and some movie stars for them to provide their solutions to this complex problem. Over the coming weeks, BP received 123,000 submissions. 123,000 submissions. Now, if you're running an innovation program, some of you may be thinking, this is great. People are engaged, people are concerned, people are passionate. But there's something you need to keep in mind here. Of those 123,000 submissions, how many of them do you think were deemed as having any value at all whatsoever? Zero, so there's the pessimistic side. This is the quiet side. So the answer is roughly a dozen. There are about 12 submissions out of 123,000 that were deemed of having any value, and it's debatable whether or not any of those contributed to the final solution. So an important thing to consider, and I'm a recovering engineer. I was educated as an engineer, but I don't think too much that way these days. But an important measure that we need to consider in the innovation process that is quite often not used is the signal-to-noise ratio. The signal-to-noise ratio is the ratio basically between what you want and what you don't want. The signal being the good thing, the noise being the thing that corrupts it. So if we're listening to music, the signal is the music, and the noise is the background hiss. In innovation, the signal are all of the great solutions that get implemented that create the value that we want to create. The noise is everything else. The noise are the ideas that people submit that are bad. The noise are all the great solutions that get submitted that never get implemented for some reason, or they're all the things that get implemented that don't create the value we want. So one of the things we really want to start focusing on is how do we reduce the noise in the innovation system? Because if we want to be more efficient in the way we innovate, we need to be able to reduce that noise. You know, and we hear an expression, and one of the things that I want you to get here is that we're enamored with in the innovation space with asking ideas. Well, guess what? Asking for ideas is a bad idea. I have never seen any organization that asks its employees, its customers, or its vendors for ideas that it doesn't implode due to the weight of the submissions. So we need something better. We need something better. Now, the thing is, we often hear the expression that we want to think outside the box. Well, this is sort of my take on it. I love this cartoon. It says, "I don't care what anyone else says. I do my best thinking inside the box." And there's actually a lot of wisdom to this, in my opinion. Basically, the mantra that I want you to consider for this first piece is that you don't want to think outside the box. You just want to find a better box. You want to find a better box, because if you find a better box, it's a different box. We will accelerate the way we innovate. And we're going to do an experiment in the middle here where we will see whether or not I can prove to you this hypothesis real time. So we're going to do a quick experiment. But first, I just want to give you some examples. And I love this quote. So this is the first of my three quotes. This is a quote from Einstein. He reputedly said, "If I had an hour to save the world, I would spend 59 minutes defining the problem and 1 minute finding solutions." Now, from my experience, most organizations are running around spending 60 minutes on things that don't matter. So the first thing we need to become masterful at is asking better questions. We need to become much better at the questions we ask, because if we ask better questions, we get better answers. So we're going to do just a quick test here. If you have a piece of paper, take it out now, because you're going to want it for this. And I want to see how quickly this group can come up with the answer. How many of you are fans of the NCAA tournament? Okay, got a few people. Great. How many of you know what basketball is? Okay, got. How many of you don't raise your hands in public? I think there's a few of you. All right, so here's what we're going to do. Imagine for a moment it doesn't matter what sports tournament you like, but let's just, for those of you who know the NCAA tournament, know how it works, you can use that as a mental model. Basically, imagine there's a sports tournament, there are 65 teams. There are 65 teams, and this tournament is what is called single elimination. Single elimination means that one team wins and advances to the next round, and another team loses and is completely eliminated. In this particular situation, we have an odd number of teams. So there's 65 teams playing. Therefore, the way we've designed our test here is that the odd team gets a bye and automatically advances into that first round. Now, if those of you who've seen the NCAA tournament will be familiar with a chart that looks something like this, I want you to start thinking about things in like this. Okay, so if we had a tournament, the question is, the question is, how many games need to be played in order to determine which team is the champion? So if you want, you can draw a chart like this. Don't shout out the answer, but when you are 100% certain of the answer, raise your hand. 100% certain. And if you think the answer is one, that's a really creative answer, but I really want to know how many games need to be played in order to determine which team is the champion. So you can go through and develop this. You can do the Sweet 16, the Final Four, whatever it is that you want to do to come up with the answer. Okay, I see one hand. When you're 100% sure, you can put your hand down, I'll get tired. I've got sort of half hands. All right, so here's the thing. I'm going to ask a different question. I'm going to ask a different question. Instead of asking how many games need to be played in order to determine which team is the champion, I'm going to ask you how many games need to be played in order to eliminate each of the losers. Remember, a team is eliminated when they lose. If there are 65 teams, how many teams need to be eliminated? 64. How many games need to be played? 64. If you were to actually do this, try this at home, don't just trust me, try this at home, and actually draw out a chart like this, you will see that, in fact, 64 games are played. And here's the point. The way we ask a question has an incredible impact on the way we think about the problem. I know this is really basic, but here's the thing. We are not educated in better question asking. We are educated in better solution finding. We are taught to be problem solvers. The most important skill that I want you to think about right now is not being a problem solver, but rather being able to frame the problem in a way that will accelerate the way that we innovate things. My favorite mantra for innovation is this. It's a very simple mantra. If you do these four things, innovation will happen in a completely different way, which is what we want to do is become better at asking the right question, the right way, of the right people, in the right way. What that means is if we ask the right question, we're asking something that's important. So it's linked back to what NASAAA's strategy is. Asking it in the right way means we are framing it in a way that we can increase the likelihood of finding a solution. Remember, the BP question, how do we stop the oil flow, is so abstract that they got a bunch of abstract and fluffy solutions. Very low signal-to-noise ratio. So we have to ask it in the right way. We need to ask it of the right people. That is, don't assume that the best and the brightest can solve every single problem in the world. No person can. And then finally, ask it in the right way means we're using the right strategies for accessing different people. So I just want to quickly introduce this concept of the Goldilocks principle. And the Goldilocks principle is this. When we're asking questions, we want to make sure that we're not doing something that is, you know, Goldilocks and the Three Bears, you know that one. Basically, it's a Goldilocks goes into the house of the three bears. There's three beds. One is too soft, one is too hard, one is just right. So we wanted to find challenges that are just right. So we don't want things that are very abstract and fluffy, like the BP oil spill, but we also don't want to have questions that are overly specific that will limit the realm of divergent thinking. So let's turn to another oil spill, 1989, in Prince William Sound of Alaska, there was the Exxon Valdez oil spill. And the Exxon Valdez oil spill, only a mere 10.8 million gallons of crude oil. Unlike the Gulf Coast, which is warm temperatures, there was one issue that had eluded the oil experts for 20 years, one problem they could not solve, and it basically was this. The waters of Alaska are near freezing temperature. And every time they tried to move the oil-water mixture, it would freeze. And they spent hundreds of millions of dollars trying to find a solution. Literally after 20 years, they did not find a solution to how do they move oil in this cold temperature in a way that it doesn't freeze. Now, what you don't realize maybe is that the question that they were asking was overly specific and of a single discipline. They had the oil experts working on it. Well, guess what? It wasn't an oil issue. They needed to actually make it a little more abstract. And when they asked the question, not how do we prevent oil from freezing, but how do we prevent, in fluid dynamics terms, how do we prevent viscous shearing, which applies to every dense liquid, regardless of temperature, how do we prevent viscous shearing from happening? That means that any dense liquid that's put under a force or acceleration will appear to freeze or solidify. How do we find a solution? Now, the solution to this one didn't come from somebody with oil expertise. It actually came from a chemist who worked in the construction industry. And this guy noticed that when they're pouring the wet cement, he had the same problem. Wet cement, a very dense liquid, when it was put under a force or acceleration, it tended to freeze, it would tend to coagulate inside the chutes. And what this guy did was develop a vibration device. It would vibrate the molecules at a particular frequency that would prevent this viscous shearing. They applied that same technology in Alaska and solved the problem. So it took 20 years of them working on an oil problem about freezing, but when they reframed it as this is about a fluid dynamics issue that applies to any discipline, any area, they got a solution in 6 weeks from somebody in construction. It changes the way we operate. So we need to ask the right question the right way. Now, I'll give you a lot of different examples from a lot of different industries just to give you a sense of the types of things that I'm talking about here. So, for example, this one's going to seem very mundane, but sometimes the mundane provides some pretty interesting insights. A mouthwash manufacturer had asked its customers, how do you want us to reformulate the mouthwash? And one of the things they heard from their customers through focus group sessions was that they wanted a mouthwash that didn't have any alcohol in it. So the scientists went off and they tried to create a mouthwash that had zero alcohol, yet was equally effective. And they couldn't do it. I mean, they spent millions of dollars trying to develop this new formulation. It sounds simple, but it wasn't. So when they hit a wall, they went back to the customers and they discovered something. The people who had asked the customers actually led the witness. They thought they didn't want alcohol. Actually, all the customers wanted was a mouthwash that didn't burn. They don't care about alcohol. Customers don't think in terms of that, but the people who were asking the customers did. And so when they thought about creating a mouthwash that doesn't burn, very, very different. They could create that very quickly. One last example in this area comes from the UK. I think this one's really fascinating. In education, we've all been trying to work on improving the educational systems. And in the UK, they wanted to do that. Now think about for a moment, if I asked you the question, how do we improve the quality of education? What are the things that come to mind? It's things like teachers and the qualifications of the teachers. It comes back to teacher pay. It comes back to infrastructure in the schools. It comes back to busing and how do we move people from place to place. There's the curriculum, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So again, this is a big abstract problem where the breadth of the solutions could be all over the map. So we need to deconstruct it. If we have something big, we need to deconstruct it. And in this case, what they did was they went off and they spent the time, again, remember the Einstein quote, 59 minutes defining the problem, 1 minute finding solutions. They spent the time to understand what is the number one factor that drives a child's learning. Any guesses? Was it? Family life is close. It's actually parental involvement. All the research shows that when parents are involved in the student's education, that is the single, by far, greatest factor that influences their educational experience and how much they will learn. It's not about the teachers. It's not about the curriculum. It's not about the schools. It's not about the buses. When we reframe the problem, we're actually able to find a solution. And what they found was there's a school in Bogota, Colombia, that has 100% parental involvement doing in this program that they've developed, and they're now adapting that program to other countries. But by understanding what is the single most important part of the problem will help you figure out how to better solve that problem. So what we're going to do is talk about something which is really important. If we ask the right question the right way, there's still a piece that we're missing here. Because here's one of the things that I said is sometimes, you know, rocket science isn't rocket science. Well, there's a reason for that also, which is I'm a big believer that expertise is often the enemy of true breakthrough innovation. Expertise is the enemy of true breakthrough innovation. And let me explain that through something which you probably all experienced. I'm a naturally messy person. I misplace everything. So if I'm looking for my keys, the odds are I will not find them where I think they should be. So imagine for a moment the last time you lost your keys and you can't find them. You're fishing around in the sofa. You're looking at your desk. You're going in the pockets of your clothes and the dirty laundry. 15 minutes goes by. You find your keys. What do you inevitably say to yourself? Can you believe it? They were in the last place I looked. Well, of course. Who finds something and keeps on looking for it? Guess what? The brain is the same way. When you are an expert, you will find a solution quickly. But that's, and you'll probably stop looking because you don't look, find something and then keep on looking for it. But what you start off with may not be new, different, or breakthrough. So I want to spend a little time exploring breakthrough thinking. And the way we're going to do that is through a little fun exercise. I think it's fun. You probably won't think so. But if you're going to be in this room, I want you to participate because there's actually a really powerful insight that we can gather at the end of this. What I need you to do is I need everybody, first of all, to pair up with one other person in the room. So turn to somebody next to you. I want everybody in a pair. Okay, great. So I'm assuming everybody's paired up. What I want you to do is I want you to imagine for a moment that this is a real brick. For those of you who are up close, you can tell this is not. I used to carry a real brick in my carry-on luggage, but after September 11th, you can imagine, not so popular with the TSA agents at the airport. So a client very graciously gave me this brick. But imagine it's a real brick, a brick that looks something like that. What I want you to do, you don't have to write anything down, but in your pairs, I want you to go back and forth and come up with as many uses of a brick as you can. So I want the first person to say something like, you can put it in a patio if you're missing a brick. The second person may say you could use it as a paperweight or maybe break it in half and use it as bookends. The first person might say, throw it at the TV if you lose the remote control. Doesn't matter, no right answers or wrong answers. You're going to do this for 45 seconds. And then I want to see what kind of solutions you came up with. So go back and forth. You don't have to write it down. Go. All right, let's stop there. I'm just curious, what are some of the the uses of a brick that you came up with. Just shout them out. And by the way, I always believe that competitions are great. So what I will do is if you come up with, and in fact, I would like you, Dr. Davis, to be the judge of this, because I don't want to be put in the spotlight. The person or team that comes up with the best solution either in the first activity or the second activity will get a copy of my Best Practices Are Stupid book. So we'll give that away if that's it. Now, here's the thing. If you suffer from insomnia, you want this book. So if that's any incentive. All right, so what were the best uses? Just shout them out.
Pencil holder.
Pencil holder, great.
A mini planter.
A mini planter, good.
An absorbent sponge.
An absorbent sponge or not absorbent? Okay, well, a sponge of sorts. Maybe better for viscous things like oil rather than water. Okay, good.
Grind it up and make it into an hourglass.
I like the connection back to the beginning. Very good.
I throw them at squirrels.
Throw them at squirrels. Okay. Good. You got your work cut out. Yes, a couple more.
Test tube holder.
Backup cruise control.
Backup cruise control, especially when you have a dead body in the trunk over the bottom. Oh, yep. Excellent. Good. Back here.
Ballast in a
spacecraft. Good connection to actually what you do. Good. You agree? Good.
Learning how to juggle.
Slightly masochist or sadist person, I guess. Or masochist, I guess is proper. Good. All right. Now, here's the interesting thing is I've done this, and I'll talk about this in a moment. I've done this with about 500,000 people now. And I do a lot of work with the Air Force. I've learned there are about 500 different ways you can kill a person with a brick. So I want to point out that you guys were not violent enough. Other than the squirrels, you're a pretty nice crowd. All right, so here's what you just did. Now, I want to point out that this is the way that most human beings find solutions to any problem they are working on. Basically, what they do is they look at the problem they're working on. So in this case, a brick and the use of the brick. That's the question. And we look at the attributes of the brick. It's dangerous, it's heavy, it's hard, it's rough, and I will find solutions based on that. We're going to do this exercise again with a twist. So the question is the same question. What are all the ways in which we can use a brick? But this time, instead of looking at the brick and the attributes of the brick, what we're going to do is start with something completely random and then find as many uses as we can of a brick in that random context. So let me give you an example. And first of all, the random thing could be anything. So for example, if the random context were on the body, you could use a brick to improve your posture. If it were a real brick, you could use it to pump up your biceps. If you have really rough skin, it's great loofah or buff your nails. Could strap it to my shoes, give me a couple of extra inches of height. If you're a soccer player, it's great protection if you're blocking a goal during a penalty kick. Lots of uses. So here's what we're going to do. In your groups, I want one person to be A, one person to be B. Decide who's going to be A and who's going to be B. All right, so here's what I want. I want person A to name something random. It can be anything. So it could be in the bathroom. In the kitchen, on a beach, we've had people use a brick in a marriage. Lots of interesting uses of a brick in a relationship. Person B will then have 45 seconds to come up with as many uses of a brick in that one random situation. So you're going to do that for 45 seconds, and then when I tell you to, and only when I tell you to, person B will get their revenge. Because person B will name something random and person A will come up with the uses. All right, so again, let's get started. Person A name something random, person B come up with the uses. I'll tell you when to switch.
Thank you.
All right, switch. Time to switch. Person B, name something random. Person A, come up with the uses. All right, just to give you the best solution I've heard yet, just if you want the benchmark, the random item was as a Halloween costume. And the winning solution was the woman could go as a brick and the man could go as a bricklayer. All right, with that, what are your best solutions? What is the random context and your one favorite solution? Usually gets a little quieter.
A heat sink.
Okay, so what was the random?
How would you use it on vacation? And I said, well, you could heat the brick up and put it in your cooler to keep your warm food warm, or keep it real cool using the heat sink.
Great. Okay, so on vacation, and then use it to adjust the temperature and whatever it is you want to adjust in. Great, good. A bicycle.
Fixing the brick to the person to lower their center of gravity, so they're more aerodynamic.
Excellent. So attaching in a way that actually lowers their center of gravity and makes them more aerodynamic and more efficient in the way they operate. Good. I see a very eager hand way in the back here. All right.
A golf tee.
Okay, and the random was golf?
Yes.
Okay, golf, and then as a golf tee. Excellent. Anyone else back here so I don't have to run back? Fishing. To get the ants that are crawling up in the sand to eat your fish and what, to beat them down?
Yeah.
Okay. I was thinking scaling the fish maybe, but okay, good. Yes?
Stand on in a pool to keep your head above water.
Okay, so the pool was the random? And to stand it to keep your head above water, excellent. Or as a flotation device for someone you don't like, good. In Hollywood? Sorry?
To hide your identity.
To hide your identity in Hollywood, so it's a mask. Excellent, good. Two more. Over there.
Yeah, the random was at a seminar. We said you could use it to teach innovative thinking.
I'm sorry, you could use it to? To teach innovative thinking. I thought you were going to say in a seminar to throw it at the speaker when you're tired of listening to him. Good. One last one. I thought I saw one more hand. All right. Okay. Going once, going twice. In cooking to keep the oven door shut. All right. Good. Do you have a winner? Yeah, whichever. Which is your favorite of, you can, however many you want. Grind it up and use it as an hourglass. Good. So see me afterwards and give me your card and I'll send you a book. So with the speaker and use it as an, great, okay, so see me afterwards, we'll get you a book, good. Now here's the important point of this. Which of these methods yielded solutions that you thought were more creative? And I want to be clear that I don't mean that you generated more solutions, and I don't mean that it was easier, but what I want to get at is the solutions you developed you thought were maybe a little further afield. You only have three options. Option one was the first way, looking at a brick and just understanding the attributes of a brick. The second way was connecting to something random. Or the third option is you felt they were roughly the same. How many of you felt the first way yielded solutions that were more creative? I see one hand. Okay, good. How many of you thought the second way yielded solutions that were more creative? Okay, maybe 75, 80%. How many of you felt they were roughly the same? Okay, a handful of you, and how many of you still don't raise your hands in public? I think there's a couple of you. Good. All right, so I've asked this question now of about 500,000 people, and what we found is that in audiences, 75 to 90% of an audience will choose the second method. Now, a couple of interesting points about this. First of all, the second method is less out of the box. Think about the first model. The first model is unconstrained, use of a brick. Second model, more constrained. We're actually putting constraints on you, which seems to paradoxically increase your level of creativity. So that's the first thing I want you to consider. The second thing is, there's a client that I worked with, very different industry. They make label makers. Label makers are a lot of times used in crafts. Now, one of the things that they did is they had their employees every morning spend 5 minutes trying to identify different uses of a label maker for different markets other than the craft market. And they started off using that first method. And what they found was that in a very short period of time, they exhausted all the obvious answers and they couldn't get anything new. So what they did was, the management team spent some time and they identified 200 different potential markets. Toll booth collectors, nurses, libraries, and they went through and they created a wall of 200 different potential uses. Each day, the employees were to choose one of the 200, were then to spend 5 minutes thinking, how can we use a label maker in a hospital? How can we use a label maker in a toll booth? And what they found was that they developed significantly more solutions. And when I've done experiments with this on real-world problems, what we found was that the first method, and I bet if we did this, even with the brick exercise, if we went around each person, if you said every single thing on your list, by the time we got through the first 4 or 5 people, we would have exhausted 70% of the ideas that existed in the entire room. Because we go to this automatic thinking. Again, it's this expertise. I understand something, I understand the context, therefore I'm going to find a solution quickly. When we use the second method, we end up with a lot of divergent thinking. And that's really the whole point here, is we want a lot of divergent thinking, which leads me to quote number two. Quote number two is from Steve Jobs. He says that creativity is just having enough dots to connect. Dots being ideas or experiences. And the reason why creative people are so is they've either had more experiences or they've thought more about those experiences. Innovation is about connecting the dots. There's also some fascinating research that comes out of Harvard Business School. And they looked at 17,000 different patents. And there was something that they discovered when they looked at these patents. Most of the patents, an extremely large percentage of them, were adaptive or derivative patents. That is, that they were built on previous patents. They're basically just improvements. And what they found was that in that situation, nearly all of the patents were solved by somebody whose domain of expertise was that of the problem. So if it's a chemistry problem, it was solved by a chemist. If it was a biology problem, it was solved by a biologist. This research also found, though, that the breakthrough solutions, the things that were not derivative of the past, were in every situation solved by either someone in a different discipline or from a multidisciplinary team. Expertise became the enemy of breakthrough thinking, and the opportunity is to recognize that the big opportunities come from other places. Let me give you some very simple examples that hopefully will illustrate this point. One is toothpaste. Now, toothpaste is probably about as common an item as exists. We use it every single day. But they're spending a lot of time and a lot of money innovating the way we brush our teeth and the way that, in one particular case, whiten our teeth. A manufacturer of toothpaste decided they wanted to find a better way of whitening toothpaste. They didn't want it to be abrasive. They didn't want to use a bleach. And they spent years and millions trying to find a solution. And then they did something which is brilliant. And this is one of the things that I want you to take away. Ask yourself a different question. The question I want you to think about is, who else has solved a problem like this? Who else has solved a problem like this? So the question isn't how we make teeth whiter. The question is, who else makes whites whiter?
Bleach.
Laundry detergent. Laundry detergent makes whites whiter. Well, guess what? Unilever, the manufacturer of this toothpaste, also has a laundry detergent division. They never talk to these guys. So they go over and they talk to the laundry detergent people and they say, hey, we're really curious. How do you make whites whiter? And they discovered something very interesting. They said, we don't. We make whites bluer. If you notice, all laundry detergent is blue, and there's a reason for that. Blue laundry detergent creates an optical illusion. It prevents the reflection of yellow. Guess what? Your clothes are still dingy yellow. You just can't see it. So the people in the toothpaste division decided this will be really good. Let's go try to create a blue toothpaste. And I have a toothpaste here that is an instant whitening toothpaste. Well, it makes it look like your teeth are white. And if you, for those of you really close, you'll see it's a toothpaste that has a blue dye right in the middle of this toothpaste. And unlike most whitening toothpastes that take 2 weeks or 6 weeks to work, this one works instantly because it creates the illusion of whiteness just like laundry detergent does. So it's a breakthrough solution. Now, one word of warning. If you use this toothpaste and you go to a party where it's really dark and they use black lights, don't smile a lot. But again, the question was, who else has solved a problem like this? We want to become masterful of this. This, to me, is the first question you always ask. Anything you're working on, I don't care what it is, who else has solved a problem like this? If it's how do we get a spacecraft to land more safely, how do we talk to Hollywood about the way they do airbags? Whatever it is, there's a solution somewhere else. Someone else has solved your problem in a different domain of expertise. Let's just take a look at this one real quickly. Gas pipelines. This is a picture of the Alaskan pipeline. It runs for hundreds and hundreds of miles. Now, gas pipelines, due to age and a number of other factors, they start to crack, they start to leak, they start to break. In the case of the Alaskan pipeline, you've got some person out there shooting moose, and they shoot the pipeline by accident, and starts spewing oil. So the question is, the problem is, how do we find where the cracks are so we can go do a permanent seal? Any guesses? A water main system? I mean, so a lot of people talk about like valves and pressure and things like that, so we can sort of sense it. Is that what you're referring to? Good. What else?
Satellite reconnaissance.
Excellent. In fact, they do pay commercial aircraft as they're flying over the tundra to do visual inspections. Good. What else?
Some kind of smoke that comes out of the hole so you can see where they are.
Okay, smoke. So that if there's a hole, it just billows out all over the place. Excellent. So the solution to this actually came from a Scottish engineer who was working on this problem. And again, this is a problem that's plagued the industry for years, and he was moving a stack of papers, and he got a paper cut. What he realized very quickly is that a gas pipeline is like the capillaries in his finger. So the question is, who else seals cracks in a fluid that's moving through a pipe or tube? Your finger. And what this guy did was he created this inert coagulant ingredient that now goes inside of gas pipelines. It'll automatically seal the cracks just the way the finger, the capillaries in the finger does. And he's working on something now that what it will do is put in a radio signal back to headquarters so they can go do a permanent fix. Now, you could have said, well, it's also like run flat tires. They get a flat and they keep on running. So there's lots of different ways. But again, build the muscle of asking, what else is this like? Who else has solved a problem like this? A very simple one. I worked in the office supply industry for a while with a company, and the second highest margin item after paper is refilled toner cartridge. So the question was, how do we get customers to return toner cartridge? Any guesses? Rebate. Okay, good first answer. Second answer is usually give a mailer. Third answer is usually appeal to their environmental goodness. Guess what? None of those really work, because every cartridge that you get already has an envelope, and left to their own devices, most people don't care about the environment. They say they do, they really don't. So what we do is we ask the question, what is this like? But again, you have to ask a different question. The question isn't how do we get people to return toner cartridge? The question is, who else sends something to a customer and you are 100% certain that the customer will send it back? Now, the first answer that we thought through is the IRS, We could not think of a usable solution for that, but the next model that we were thinking about was Netflix, exactly, Netflix 1.0. And we actually created a subscription toner cartridge, Netflix-like model for toner cartridge. You'd be getting this great deal, you'd never run out, very, very easy. So when we asked what is it like, we got a totally different solution. Now, you might not think this is the breakthrough of the universe, but it's a breakthrough for them because it's a fundamentally different business model around something that matters to them. We'll do one last one here, and then I want to introduce one other concept, which is angioplasty. I was just speaking in Vegas at Caesar's Palace about a month ago, and the company I was working with is in the simulation realm. They actually will simulate anything that's in the real world, in the virtual world, and be able to do these beautiful and accurate statistical models. The problem is you need the data. And they were working with a medical device company trying to simulate the way that the angioplasty balloons work inside the body. And they were struggling to find the model. And they were talking with somebody about this, and they said, oh, this is really interesting. We just did a simulation for one of the car manufacturers for their airbags. And as it turns out, the way an airbag explodes and contracts is exactly the way an angioplasty works. And they were able to use the model from a car in the body. So what we want to do is, again, become really masterful at making these connections. And here's the point. And this is a chart that's a very simple chart, but I think it's very powerful. And there's a lot of interesting things in here, which is if we want to go for breakthrough solutions, what we want to do is, more than anything else, get a higher number, a higher diversity of people. Because the more we can get people from other disciplines looking at our problem, or the more we can at least think about who else has solved a problem like this, maybe in a different discipline, we are more likely to find the problem. Now, our natural inclination when finding solutions is to start at the bottom. We've got a team of people who are working on a problem. We're going to give them the problem and see if they can find the solution. But the opportunity here is to go broader. So how do we go within the organization? I mean, there's just incredible resources, even here, you know, in Houston, in other groups where you could get breakthrough solutions for propulsion from food. I don't know. I mean, there's, you know, start thinking about what are these connections. But then how do you go to other parts of NASAA? There's some breakthroughs there. And then also, how do we go further out into open markets? The more we start thinking about these connections and looking in unlikely places, the more likely we are to find breakthrough solutions. So one of the ones that I love is this, a potato chip manufacturer. Potato chip manufacturer wanted to find a way of reducing the fat in their potato chips. And the way they wanted to do it, they wanted the potato chips to taste the same as regular potato chips, so they weren't going to bake them or anything like that. They actually wanted to be able to deep fry the potato chips and somehow pat off or shake off the fat. So what they did was they tried a quick test. They created a little assembly line. They would deep fry the potato chips, put them on a conveyor belt. They would vibrate the conveyor belt. They could actually see the fat dripping off the potato chips, and at the end of the conveyor belt was a bag where they put the potato chips. So by the time it got to the end, they had low-fat potato chips, but they had one problem. Yeah, the potato chips were crumbs. So what they needed to do is they needed to ask a different question, and they leveraged the crowds for this particular one, and they asked the question, how do we vibrate something that's extremely fragile without breaking it? How do we vibrate something extremely fragile without breaking it? Now, the solution to this problem did not come from somebody in the food industry. I mean, our first thoughts sometimes go to eggs and how do we prevent the breakage of eggs. But the solution didn't even come from an engineer. It actually came from someone who is a musician. This musician hypothesized that when he was playing his music, he could feel the bones in his head vibrate. What if I could use that same process to vibrate potato chips just the right way? So he went home, cooked up some potato chips, put them on a drying rack, put a loudspeaker over it, played with the frequency, played with the volume, could actually see the potato chips dance, the fat fall off, the potato chips didn't break. Breakthrough solution from someone in a totally different field. That's the opportunity. I mean, clearly that one was not rocket science. I mean, this is one of those things where we're looking for opportunities in other different places. Very last example, this is something that is brand new that was just announced a few months ago, which was the AIDS virus. They've been working on the AIDS virus for years, trying to understand how the AIDS virus works and the enzymes associated with it, and molecular biologists have been studying this. And one of the things that they know is that the reason why the AIDS virus is so virulent is because it's able to fold itself in ways that are more and more and more efficient, which allows it to propagate. So to find a solution for the ways that it can fold itself better, they didn't turn to molecular biologists. Did anybody read this one anywhere? Video gamers, yeah. What they did was they created a video game called Fold It. They had 250,000 video game players, and the rules were very simple. As you fold a molecule a particular way, if you fold it in a way that makes it more efficient, you get points. If you fold it in a way that makes it less efficient, you get deducted points. And they just recently released a paper where they believe they've actually cracked the code on how this works, which was a major breakthrough in AIDS research. So again, this is one of those things that if we can start getting more effective and more creative in not just in finding our solution with our people, but rather get more creative in the way we find and source solutions from other sources, this is a really powerful thing. So I'm going to pause here before I move to the third quote and just see, are there any questions that you have so far? I'm not a big fan of taking questions at the end. I'd rather take them now if you have any. So any questions so far in anything I've talked about? Yes, over there. We'll just wait for the microphone, I think.
Hi.
Hi there.
In some of your previous examples, you cited wasted resources and time and effort before the companies realized that they hadn't been asking the question the right way.
Yeah.
Or that they could have asked the questions more broadly or more narrowly. So what are really are the criteria by which you should go by to know that you have asked the question or defined the problem the right way?
That's a fantastic, so you asked the right question, which is very good. And that's something which is hard to encapsulate into 5 minutes. It actually is a process we go through. But here's some very, very simple litmus tests that you can use. One is just say to yourself, what are the types of solutions I could get if I were to ask this? And what you could find, I mean, if you don't mind, I'd like to use an example that I know you've talked about before, Dr. Davis, about the zero gravity laundry. Is it okay if I use that one? Yes? Okay. I want to make sure. Okay, good. So, I mean, there's a lot of great things that's been, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how NASAâ has been leveraging some open innovation just a little bit, but there's one challenge, which I think is just a great challenge, which was, if I remember correctly, and correct me if I'm wrong, the question was, how do we create a zero gravity laundry system? So, great question. Then the next step is to think about, okay, first of all, is it too complex? And that's, are we creating something that's too big? And in some respects, systems imply too big. It also may imply some type of solution. Okay, well then, how do we bring it down a little bit? So what's the result that we want? Well, we want a system that we want to be able to clean clothes. Okay, well, that's a little more specific, but we could go one step further, which would be how do we create clothes that don't need to be cleaned? So it's just this iterative process of trying different things and testing them out and just saying what types of solutions are we going to get and are we allowing ourselves to get solutions from other places? And then ask yourself, who else has solved the problem like this? Now, is there anything that you want to add to this? In terms of the experience you've had, is there anything you want to add to what you've seen in terms of this or anything else that you've done with open innovation so far?
Sure. So that we had talked with Stephen about that one as one that we had written at the wrong level and too broadly, but we also wrote some like for the food system and solar flare challenge you've heard about before, where we got some really interesting solutions back in areas we didn't think we would. And so we ran fairly tough technical problems and got solutions. We actually went into these pilots not thinking we would actually get solutions. So we're now wanting to move to the next step where these tools are more generally available for everyone and start thinking through how do we do that training, that education back to the question over here about how do you write good questions, how you write good challenges. It works in a lot of different arenas.
Yeah, I mean, this is. I mean, again, we're not in my objective here is really to give you the thought process at a high level, not the answer. But it really is, I mean, if you ask, even if you just start asking questions of crowds, I mean, I love the solar flare example. I mean, who would have thought that somebody from the cell phone industry is going to have the answer to that one? I mean, that's just, you know, it's one of those things where you don't know the answer. Here's the other thing which I want you to consider. Just consider this, is the natural inclination that we have when we're tasked with solving a problem is we want to first go try to solve the problem ourselves, and if we run into a roadblock, we then go enlist the help of someone else. The opportunity today, and this is what I'm going to get into a little bit now, is the opportunity is actually in a very low-cost, low-risk way is to actually test the market and understand what's already known or not known about this topic in a way that we can accelerate things and not reinvent the wheel, and then we can build on that kernel of knowledge that we gain from it. So most companies go internally first and then only go externally. My bias is, let's start externally. It's so cheap and so fast, and then based on what we see, we will know how much resource we need to put internally. But great question, and it's, again, hard to give you like a very three-word soundbite on that one. Any other questions? Yes?
So you've given a lot of good examples where the solution to a problem came from a non-expert, and you're advocating non-experts. But obviously there are a lot of good solutions that come from experts. So is there some guidance on the character of a question or a character of a problem where you would turn to experts versus non-experts? Is there any way to differentiate which crowd you should be asking for solutions?
Great question. So the question is, I gave a lot of examples of where we go externally. And I do that intentionally just because our natural inclination is to go internally. And I want to make it clear, 80% to 90% of what you work on, you're going to work on internally. And I'm going to show you a little chart here. So I'm going to hold off on answering that when I get to a chart in a moment, which we'll talk about these things a little bit. Because the objective is not to outsource what you do, but rather to focus on what you do best. Because if you're spending 80%, sort of Pareto, if you're spending your time on things that matter, you're going to spend 20% of your time on the things that maybe are so difficult that's going to take 80% of your time. So if you can eliminate that 20% that someone else has a solution to and you can focus on that, you will double or triple your productivity, because I know no one here is working 20-hour work weeks. I mean, everybody's really busy. So the question is, how do you get focused on the things where you can make the greatest impact? I'll come back to that when I do a chart. One last question. Yes, in the back.
When you talked about the BP oil spill example, you said that they received, you know, in excess of 123,000 solutions. If we pose a broad problem like that, how do you sift through 123,000 solutions in a scalable manner that's not cost prohibitive and not time consuming?
Great. Okay, so the question is, if you do have 123,000, how do you do it? First of all, if you do a quick back of the envelope calculation, if you had one person, which is obviously not how you do this, but if you had one person who was tasked with evaluating 123,000 submissions, and you gave them 30 seconds per submission, so basically they read it and then they click, read it and click, yes, no, yes, no. So really, really fast. It would take them 6 months to evaluate. So what's happened is, we've gone into situations where organizations now, because of the quantity of ideas that they're getting, want to use the crowds to evaluate. The problem is crowds are great at providing solutions. They're really, really bad at providing insight and evaluating. Now, I'll tell you how to do it in a second, but I'll tell you how not to do it first. And this is an example that comes from California, Arnold Schwarzenegger, when he was the governor. Some of you may have read about this, where he set up a website where people could provide solutions on how to deal with the economic woes of California. And then he allowed the citizens to also vote up and down what they liked. What was the number one most popular submission? Legalized marijuana. Legalized marijuana was by far the most popular one, and what we find is when it comes to voting, there's this thing called mob sourcing. And basically the psychology is either it's tied to a personal agenda or what's popular becomes more popular. So unfortunately, most voting systems, internal, external, don't work. The way you can do it that is scalable is instead of asking for what they like, ask them to eliminate the duds. Ask them to eliminate the ones that are bad. Now, yes, you will eliminate some things that might be good. That is natural. And there's other things that you can do through some analysis to find those. But for the most part, instead of asking what they like, ask them what they don't like. Human beings are very, very good at finding the duds. They're not very good at finding the gold. So if you have them eliminate the top 90%, top 95%, the things that are obviously ridiculous answers, the things that are repeats, the things that are just, we know they're not going to work, we can then have a team of experts evaluate the remaining ones. Because it actually takes some context knowledge to really understand whether something will work or won't work. So at least that's from my experience, the best way to do a scalable evaluation process is to get the crowds to eliminate the bad ones and then use a lens of expertise on the other ones. There's other models that are emerging that have promise, but none of them work particularly well, in my opinion, yet. So that's the only thing that I've seen that works well. All right, so let's move on to the last piece here, which is that, a quote from one of my favorite TV shows, Mythbusters. Failure is always an option. I mean, that's something which we just have to get, is that no matter what you do, failure is going to happen. But we have this sort of perverted relationship with failure inside of innovation departments. And I think part of it is attributed to good old Edison. So Edison reputedly said, I have not failed 700 times, I have not failed once. I have succeeded in proving that those 700 ways will not work. When I've eliminated the ways that will not work, I will find the way that works. This is an incredible and valuable learning. So we seem to think that failure is great from a learning perspective, but here's the thing. Had Edison found the solution to the filament for the incandescent light bulb on the first try, I guarantee you he was not going to try 700 more times in the name of learning. So we've over-glorified the value of quote-unquote failure because we think we learn from it and we have to make mistakes, and the reality is we have to make mistakes. That is the reality. But we can do it differently. And the way that we can do it differently is through this chart here that I have. If you look at the traditional model we use for developing solutions, it would be what is considered to be the iterative development, which is basically what Edison did. Try, fail, try, fail, try, fail, try, fail. And it looks something like this. I fail, I fail, I fail, I fail. And after 700 times or however many times, you succeed. This is the way we tend to innovate. Now, the downside of this model is that it costs us when we fail each and every time, and it costs us when we succeed because we had to pay somebody to be able to go through that failure. And by the way, the timeline associated with this is very long. So if we turn this model on its side and we think about it as a massive parallel process of successes and failures where the failures don't cost us as an organization anything, it costs the market something, and we are able to do things in parallel, then it speeds things up. We end up with fail, 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 succeed, fail. But the difference is, the model is that this time we only pay for the success in terms of what its value is to us, and we also collapse the time frame because we have large markets of people working in parallel. Now, I'll give you a few examples of this, but I do want to just give you one perspective that I have, and it comes from Will Rogers. He said, there's nothing so stupid as an educated man if you get him off the thing that he was educated in. You guys are experts. You're experts in what you do. I mean, there's no disputing that. You are the best and the brightest on the planet, and the envy of anyone in the world. But you cannot solve every single problem. So the thing which we need to become better at is understanding what problems can we solve and what problems can't we solve. And this is just a very simple chart, and this is the chart that I was referring to, that I like to use, which is normally we believe we can solve all of these, and the reality is you might be able to solve all of these. But if we think about a bell curve of challenges, a bell curve of problems that we're working on the left-hand side, we're going to have things that we know someone has a very simple off-the-shelf solution that we can buy. And that we want to use tech scouting. Let's go out and just say, you know what, we know, we just, our gut tells us there's a solution out there. let's go find somebody and license or buy the intellectual property from them. On the other side is where we can either issue an RFP and find a solution provider, or we can use some form of crowdsourcing where we can buy a solution. And then in the middle are the things which are your core discipline. And this is something which takes a little bit of experimentation and thought processes. For every challenge, the things you want to ask yourself is, first of all, have we framed the challenge the right way? Make sure that we've defined it properly. We haven't eliminated the possibility that solutions could come from other disciplines. And then do a quick gut check to say, how much of this can we solve and how much of it can we go externally? And there's, after you do this for a while, become better and better at it. I mean, obviously, if it's something you've been working on and you don't have an answer, going externally is a good thing. I was working with one company. They spent $100 million in 10 years on this one problem. They couldn't solve it. So they went externally to find a solution. They got a solution. It was a document that was mathematical proof that what they were looking to do was absolutely, positively impossible. They realized very quickly that if they had started there, they would have saved themselves a lot of time and money. So you need to just do this gut check on some of this thing. This is not a science. I can't give you the five questions that you're always going to know, but you're going to have to use a little bit of a gut check on this. Our objective is not to outsource work to the others, but for you to focus on what you do best, because you are experts in what you do more than anything else. I want to talk about just some examples of crowdsourcing, because I think these are just useful to talk about three different models of crowdsourcing that are typically used. And the first model is sort of this public forum for discussion around something broad. And this is what GE is doing with their eco-imagination. And basically what this is they've defined, I will call it a broad and abstract thing that they're looking for, which is something that's ecological in nature. And people can provide, as you see, different types of things here, whether it's an electronic engine or wind power or other types of things that improve efficiency of power. But it's a really big question. And people start providing submissions, and then they can build on each other and vote things up and down. And I view these types of models, and also this model, which is another one similar to it but a little different, which is Cisco. Cisco had their Cisco prize, and basically what it was is a competition where the top 64 submissions who could define the next billion-dollar business for them would go into the round, and 64 was down to 32, 32 to 16, et cetera. And I view both the GE and the Cisco model as what I will call the American Idol version of innovation. And what the American Idol version of innovation is basically it's the best of what we get submitted, and we end it when we end it, so whatever we get, we get. Now, I happen to have insider information, not from these two companies, but from other companies that have done this, and basically what they say is the results are more good marketing PR and very bad from an innovation perspective. The solutions that they typically get with these types of models don't yield what they want because they get the best of a bunch of junk for the most part. One mobile phone company that had been doing this actually shared with me all their data, and the winner, on a scale from 1 to 5, the judges chose the winner as a 3 out of 5. Most of the submissions were a 1.5 to 2 out of 5. Low, low value. Good marketing. It makes them look good. It makes them look innovative. No value in it whatsoever. So the model that I like the most is this one. And this is something which many of you have heard of. How many of you know the Netflix handful of people? In a nutshell, what Netflix realized was that their customers were leaving them in droves because once they watched the TV shows and movies that they wanted, there was nothing else that they wanted to watch. So Netflix decided that if we could improve our recommendation engine, hey, you just watched this TV, watch this one. If they could improve it by 10%, that was worth millions and millions of dollars. So they ran a challenge. And in that challenge, they said anybody who can find a solution to this, improve our recommendation by 10%, will get $1 million. The first one to do it. This challenge went on for quite some time, and in the end, as you'll see, the number one team, it was 7 people from around the world with 7 different disciplines who came together virtually to find the solution. And they got the $1 million, and Netflix got something that is worth tens of millions of dollars and would have cost them tens of millions of dollars to develop. Now think about the chart that I drew before. fail, succeed. If Netflix tried to do this on their own, they would have spent all that money. Instead, they had this massive parallel process. You look at all these other teams, number 2, 3, 4, 10, 12, and there's others below the fold here that spent their time and money in developing solutions that ultimately they got nothing for. Netflix paid for the prize based on its value, and they had all these teams competing in parallel. This is the big opportunity. And if you're not aware of it, and I just took this snapshot this morning, NASAâ does have a pavilion on the Innocentive website where there are challenges running and challenges that have run, where you can see what's being done there. Now, I don't know if you want to talk about what you're doing. Maybe after I'm done, you want to talk about what's being done with open innovation or something, but I think that would be, you know. But here's the opportunity is, whether it's Innocentive or other models, there's dozens and dozens of models for being able to go externally and collaborate. Really think through, for everything you're working on, who is best suited to find a solution to this. Because I think that's the real opportunity here. So what I've covered in our time together are three things. Basically, we want to focus on challenges, not ideas. We need to become masterful at defining the problem, defining it well. Instead of looking for lots of abstract, fluffy solutions and ideas, we want to really laser focus on the things that are going to matter and define them in ways that we can accelerate the definition of solutions. Second thing is diversity, not homogeneity. How do we bring connections? How do we connect the dots? As Steve Jobs said, how do we connect the dots? How do we bring new perspectives together? And then finally, parallel processing, not serial processing. How do we do things in a way that we can do things 10 times faster with the same amount of work because we're actually parsing it out into these parallel streams of work? So I have a couple of other things that I want to close with, but I just want to pause here before I close and see what other questions there are from the group. Okay, and let me close with a couple of quick stories. The first story I want to close with is I had the great pleasure of working when I was living in England for 3 years working with a Formula One team. How many of you know what Formula One is? So half of you. So Formula One are really, really fast race cars. You can see these guys working around the car here. These cars cost about $1.5 million each to build. They go from 0 to 100 miles an hour, back to zero in less than 5 seconds. They go from 100 miles an hour to a full stop in less than 2 seconds, and they showed me computer simulations that if we could get a tunnel that was long enough, it could actually ride upside down on the ceiling of the tunnel, much like the Men in Black car, due to the incredible aerodynamics of these cars. Of course, for people who are in space, that's not that big of a deal, because just use Velcro and you'd be attached to the ceiling. That's a very different situation. But in our world here, that's pretty incredible. The thing that always amazed me most about Formula One, it wasn't the car, it wasn't the driver, it's actually these people who are doing the pit stop. Back when I worked with the team, the pit crew consisted of 20 people, and those 20 people had a number of different tasks. So you had 4 people who would remove the lug nuts from each of the 4 tires. You had 8 people who would remove the tires and replace the new tire. You had people who were fueling the car, people working the jacks, and the guy working the lollipop that told them when to go and when to stop. The way the pit crews get efficient is they will sit there with a stopwatch and they will time the 20 people and they will do this over and over and over again. And what they find is that there's a point that no matter how hard they try, no matter how hard they push themselves, they can't go 1/1000th of a second faster. It is the fastest possible time that the pit crew can go. This is it. They decided to try an experiment. And the experiment was this. Instead of telling the pit crew members that they were going to measure it on speed, they were going to be measured on style. So yes, they needed to go fast, but it was not about the stopwatch, which is in the future and is the goal, but rather it's about being present in the moment, the style. So as you're changing the tires, think smooth. As you're fueling the car, think smooth. As you're changing the aerodynamics, think smooth. When they did this, when they weren't trying to go fast, but they were focused on the present, they were able to go 2/10 to 3/10 of a second faster and what seemed to be the best possible time. Yet when you asked the pit crew members if they thought they were going faster or slower, everyone on the pit crew thought they were going slower. And I call this the performance paradox. When we are focused on something, we have in our head that we need to push hard, we need to work hard, we need to hit the goals, hit our targets, because this is what we're taught to do. But in fact, this is the thing which very often destroys innovation. We see this in physical activities like this. I did a study with athletes who are approaching major milestones, like Barry Bonds hitting the home run record. As they get closer and closer to the milestone, their performance gets worse and worse and worse and worse. Barry Bonds was 10 times worse in the months leading up to that milestone. It's just human behavior. We've done the same thing with people trying to study and creativity work. Creativity work actually drops off to almost zero when you're pushing people. So the best piece of advice I can give you is, in addition to all the things I talked about, which is asking better questions, is to actually give yourself permission to breathe. Give yourself permission to not be so focused on the result. A guy I know is an incredible innovator, works in the smell industry. Scents, they make perfumes and other types of things. And he needed to develop 40 different scents every day. That was the corporate target. And when he and his team tried to hit 40 different new innovations every day, they failed. So with nowhere else to turn, he tried something pretty wacky. Now you gotta get, this is a guy who's got long ponytail and sort of like a little new agey, but he tried something. He took the whole team out, this is in England, took them out to Stonehenge. And they meditated for just a half hour before the day, and then they spent the day working on it. Since that day, they've used that as a practice, because every day when they weren't focused on hitting the 40, they hit the 40. When they took the time up front to actually relax and get them in the right mindset, they always perform better. There's a part of the brain called the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex that actually is very judgmental. And when we're focused on the goals and the objectives and the numbers, we shut that off, and that's the thing which shuts off our ability to develop breakthrough solutions. We develop our breakthrough solutions when we're relaxing, whether it's in bed or in the shower or meditating or yoga, and you need to find your own method for that, because that will allow you to develop breakthroughs faster. So I think it's just really important for us to get that this is not just all about do, but it's also about not doing. Sometimes we need to reflect, step back, and become more efficient in the way we do things. So I'm going to skip this next slide and just go right to this one. This is a slide that I took in the Daintree Rainforest of Australia. In the Daintree Rainforest, there's this bird called the cassowary. And the cassowary is this slow bird that has the bad habit of getting run over. So I took this picture, and throughout the rainforest, you'll see these signs. Cassowary bird, speed bump. This is actually not the picture that I took. I photoshopped this picture. For those of you who can't see it, the bottom is the before and the top is the after. I want you to become masterful at connecting the dots. That is the key. I want you to take the time to reflect. I love this quote. I'll read it to you because you may not be able to see it because it's the smallest font of anything I have, but it's a really great quote that was given to a group of people at West Point. I'll just read it for you. He says, I find for myself that my first thought is never my best thought. My first thought is always someone else's. It's always what I've already heard about the subject, always the conventional wisdom. It's only by concentrating, sticking to the question, being patient, letting all the parts of my mind come into play that I arrive at an original answer. By giving my brain a chance to make associations, draw connections, take me by surprise. And often even that idea doesn't turn out to be very good. I need time to think about it, to make mistakes, to recognize them, to make false starts and to correct them, to outlast my impulses, to defeat my desire to declare the job done and move on to the next thing. We need to give ourselves space in order to be able to innovate more efficiently. We need to become better at connecting the dots. Ask yourself who else has solved a problem like this. Recognize that the breakthrough solutions are going to often come from somewhere else. My favorite expression is that if you are working on an aerospace engineering problem and you have 100 aerospace engineers working on it and you can't find a solution, guess what? The 101st aerospace engineer is not going to make that much of a difference. But if you add a nanotechnologist, you add a biologist, you add a musician, you may actually find some of the breakthroughs. So I thank you very much. Go forth and innovate.
Stephen, thank you very much. Always appreciate the overview and getting into the culture and techniques of innovation. And we're constantly looking for ways to see how we can train ourselves. And so very much appreciate the time. It was a great lecture.
Thank you.
We have a small token for you here, which is a montage.
Oh, excellent.
From the Johnson Space Center. So we hope you enjoy that.
Thank you.
Again, thanks for coming. I don't know what your immediate departure schedule is, but if some of you have some questions that want to come on down, come on down. But we'll go ahead and end the WebEx here at this point. But thank you again. It was
great.
Thank
you very much. And if you are the one who won the book, make sure you give me your card. Thank you. This is lovely.